begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. It's good to see all the faces here tonight. Chris Hawkins, our chair, will be with us, I understand, a little bit later this evening. So until then, I will be the MC for the time being. Firstly, though, there's a sign-up sheet that's going around. If you could make sure you, if you could put your name on that, it would be helpful to know who's here. This is actually a facilities committee meeting to give feedback to them as well as to the school board on their proposal to the school board. So I want to very quickly here hand over the meeting to Gary Jablonski and Chris Bauer, who are here in the front. I'd like to recognize a couple other people who are in attendance, which are Dan Bisson and Jim Delisle, who are over here in the corner. They are with Team Design, which is the architectural firm that we've been working with over a good period of time now. And before I hand the microphone over to Chris, when you have the opportunity to speak, if you would please say your name clearly so that Joanne can make sure she records that. Thanks, Chris and Gary.
What we'd like to do, first of all, I'm talking at the microphone because this is the one way that I think can help folks here as well as the folks at home here. So when we get to the point where we invite folks to come up and make comments, please come up here. It helps us get the word out about things. So the process, basically, I'm Chris Bauer. The process will be that Gary is going to summarize, describe the recommendations coming from the committee, and then I'm just going to help moderate, helping folks express their opinions, and we may be able to answer some questions. We may defer other questions to members of the school board or to Team Design or to other members of the committee who are in the audience, and we'll just go from there. So I'm going to turn it over to Gary.
Good evening. These are the recommendations from the Newmarket School Facilities Committee to the Newmarket School Board. I'm just going to read them verbatim. After substantial study and discussion among the members of the committee, community guests, school administrators, and our architectural consultant, the committee makes the following recommendations for action to the Newmarket School Board. Given that Plan A, purchase of the Rockingham Country Club land and construction of a new grade 6 through 12 middle high school, was not supported by the vote in spring of 2005, our so-called Plan B recommendation is a stepwise approach. We recommend that the school board acquire land in proximity to the current school properties for improvement of school facilities as shown on base map number 2404A, dated October 26, 2006, sheet 2 of 2, drawn by Doucette Survey Incorporated, as signed by Chris Bauer, chairman of the committee, as soon as possible and if possible without bonding. The committee was of strong opinion that obtaining land suitable for expansion of school facilities was critical. The committee supports the ongoing negotiations concerning properties adjacent to the current school properties as a positive alternative to the golf course site. The committee's investigations and the research by the school administration and architect indicate that there are no clear alternative sites in Newmarket suitable for school construction. If the land can be obtained without obtaining additional funds through bonding, the committee feels strongly that there is nothing to lose by doing so. At minimum, the land is an investment that will retain and likely grow in value. With land in hand, a vote to bond funds for construction is less complicated. Thus, there is little risk in going ahead and great risk if nothing is done. Part two, seek bonding to support architectural and engineering fees in association with future facility needs at the senior high school level. If we are able to proceed to considering construction of a new high school facility, initial architectural design and engineering, A&E, must be completed first. The cost of these two items can be combined and voted on as one package or considered separately one after the other. The committee believes that separating the A&E from construction allows a specific design to be developed and precise cost to be presented to voters. The additional time provided by separation also allows for greater community input regarding specific design features, which would build on the work of the community task force later fall. If these are combined in a single item, the cost can only be an estimate.
Kathleen, whether it would make sense at this point to have you basically kind of present some of the same information you've presented to the committee and to the board previously in terms of the context for some of these things, if that's okay with the board.
Sure, I think that's good background.
Dan, is that okay with you? Okay.
Where would be the best place to?
Probably right here.
Hello, my name is Dan Bisson from Team Design. We're located in Manchester, and we've been working on this project for several years, starting off with some facilities analysis for the existing junior senior high, including the elementary school. Over that period of time, the map across from me was a review of many different options, different sites. That took a course of a year just reviewing. Anybody came up with a site that met some of the generic criteria of acreage, accessibility, soil water. Those are all the accumulations of different sites we reviewed. As you know, last year we had focused on one, which is the golf course, and that one became an issue for a variety of reasons, and those reasons became an accumulation of data that we revisited one of the options, and it opened up some possibilities, which happens to be this particular plan here. This is the junior senior high school that as it exists right at this point in time. The nursery is across the street, which is the Carpenter property, and behind the junior senior is a ballpark area which was developed by some federal monies. There is also some potential capability of expanding to the west of this property as well. When we found the combinations of these sites, which we didn't have the following year because we were looking only at the Carpenter, we could not fulfill all those obligations in the sense of the amount of fields and the size of the buildings. We also looked at this differently in the sense of breaking up the building into two versus keeping everything under one brand new building. We really looked hard, and the committee really asked a lot of questions about, let's say we were to keep the existing facility for a middle school, and let's say we were to look only at a high school. That opened up those avenues that made these combinations of property a lot more viable. So with that said, we walked the site in September with different professionals for wetlands, civil engineers, architectural, and we came up with this generic concept to really test it out. And what we came up with is having the high school near the adjoining property on the west, near these ball fields, and having across the street a capability of play fields. We did try to attempt to footprint the building, but that's about all we could get on the Carpenter property. We didn't have enough room for parking, circulation, bus pickup and drop off. but it does afford us what a variety of play fields. With that said, we have enough play fields on this side to take care of all the PE requirements. And after school, this would be quite advantageous because it's also accessible by two entrances off the main road, which is really nice. So this could actually be used quite easily in a community-based type of recreational facility. So for school days, everything's intact on this side of the road. Middle school and high school, those fields are more than adequate for PE. After school, expanding programs, extracurricular, it all works out. As I say, with that, we did some preliminary wetlands mapping. We did some preliminary topography checking, and we feel pretty comfortable that we would be able to get identically all the different pieces that we had shown on the golf course property the year prior. The high school itself would be about 100 to 110,000 square feet. It's cut down close to half of what it was the year before. Its capacity is about 538. It has future growth to about 712. So it has all the flexibility as we had last year, so it has potential growth. Leaving the junior-senior school for middle school, the thought there was to do some minor renovations to make it more comfortable, and the board and the facilities committee felt that by waiting and moving in as a middle school, see how it works, and then wait some time to really go in there and to do some major renovation rather than go in and do a full-blown renovation right away, move in and kind of live in it for a while. It also offers possibility of moving one of the grades from the elementary school that would give some potential elbow room. So that all kind of looked like it would lead in the right direction, that it would help relieve a lot of the pressure on the elementary as well. At this point in time, we've gone very little further than this, other than trying to answer the questions Department of Ed would require us, and we've given them a full briefing on this. We also met the requirements for access to the site. Of course, right now you'd go over the stream, that would be upgraded totally. We know with the issue with the rainfall we had last year, that had a real issue when we rebuild that crossing. A second access would be by the community center, which is already established as an emergency 911 access. We also have some possibilities that there's some lands behind the elementary school that is being looked at as a connection to the high school. That would be a bonus. Right now we're just looking into that, but we have all the capability of meeting Department of Ed rules and guidelines, so we feel very comfortable this process would include state funding without any issues. That's about not a good briefing enough at this point.
Yeah, let me just interject that this is conceptual picture of what could be, and the facilities committee basically was moving to the position where we didn't have a feasible large plot of land to build a combined 6th through 12th grade, plus the finances associated with that, which is why the previous vote was unsuccessful. So we went back and looked at it from how can we make this smaller pieces, how can we make this broken down into something that could be more stepwise. And so the idea of a first step is the land issue in terms of acquiring land in these particular areas. And these particular areas of land provides the opportunity when the time comes to make that decision of building just the high school, a 9 to 12 grade at one particular point in time, and then revisiting the issue of the current building and the middle school at a different time. So we're trying to decouple those more manageable bites. So that's the general kind of overall model that we're taking here. So I think maybe, unless someone else has something to interject right now, maybe the appropriate thing to do would be to allow folks to ask questions or raise comments. And again, we'd like you to come up here to do that. And I'm going to leave this up here so folks can see it. And then wherever the question is appropriate to go to, we'll figure out who might be the appropriate person to address that. So come on up. This will still be on.
Hi, Rich Alperin, 204 South Main. In a recent newspaper article, there was discussion that some landowners were refusing to sell the land to the town. Could you address the issue and point out on this map where that land is and what could happen if an agreement can't be reached?
Kathy, would you like to take that?
Thanks, Rich. That's a great question, and I know that that has been a great deal of discussion in the community. In fact, we have been in negotiations, as you know, with two landowners. The Carpenters we are currently negotiating with and moving forward with that. However, the property that is adjacent to Field B, which is owned by the Mr. and Mrs. Wyatt, they are not interested in selling. They've made that very clear that they do not want to sell that property. At this point, the members of the school board are looking at their options relative to that and what does that mean in terms of this project. So at that point, again, at this point in time, we're still in conversation, but they're not interested in selling. Sure. Right here. Right. A lot of people have asked why not across the street at Carpenters, and I think Dan highlighted that for you tonight, in that when you put a building with about 100,000 square feet plus multiple accesses, which you must have at least two accesses, that's standards that we must meet by the Department of Education, along with parking and bus drop-off and so forth, that particular site, given the wetlands that are there, we would not be able to have a building built there. So that piece of land adjacent to Field B was important, but at this point we're sort of at a standstill.
I joined a committee and was on the land search, and just wanted to clarify that the Wyatt property, we were looking at the raw backland, not their home. So it was land that was in back, and it was something that would be cut off from their main house. And you know, there are still options that the school board can take, but I didn't want anyone to think that we were looking to have them sell their home and have to be displaced there. It's simply the back land that we were looking at.
13 acres.
13 acres. I got it. I'll just hold on. If anybody else would like to come up and ask questions or have comments, just come on up, and I'm just going to hand you this when you get here.
Could someone who walked that land talk a little bit about that piece of land and how it's laid out? You know, how, what the access is, et cetera.
I had walked the land with soil scientists, some committee members, civil engineer. The Carpenter property was the first one we walked. It's generally flat for the most part, had been farmed over the years. Mr. Carpenter walked with us. He actually blazed some trails for us, which was quite unique. And we found that two parts of the site had some wetlands. This portion here, which is the northwesterly, was created due to some drainage, uses of methods of draining. And this is not as significant of a wetlands and could be mitigated. To the northeast was a more significant because there is a stream running through the northern portion, and this area would be more difficult to actually work out as a mitigation. We also took a serious look at the town property up in this area. I forget the development back here, if somebody could help me.
River Bend.
This was deeded over as common land for recreational use for the town. And that's, for the most part, is wetlands, and that's probably why it got deeded. It wasn't buildable because they built on the best land. So we really concentrated on the Carpenter property, and what you're showing here is mostly the non-wetland area. Other than this field, would take over a portion of some of the less quality wetlands. the Weir property, we had walked in on the lower end by the river, and there is definitely a strip of wetlands along the river. It's fairly clearly defined. But from the river to about two-thirds of the site is very gently sloping. The beginning of it is pretty flat, then gently sloping. The back portion does rise very, very quickly and would be difficult to build on. We also took a look at where the ballpark is, and the same thing is true, that hill, that toe of slope, this portion is fairly steep. The types of soils in there are fairly sandy and very buildable. It's a very nicely wooded area. We still have to do a little more homework in a sense of due diligence in regards to the wetlands, but nothing stuck out of Jim Goves, who was our wetlands person, that couldn't be overcome. So it was just a nice property. From what I understand, when they built these play fields, this was similar to that site. And you can see from the ball fields, it's fairly flat, fairly sandy. So we're expecting much of the same.
In terms of access, though?
Yeah, the access, what we would really look at is use the existing access over the river, the stream. That culvert really got weathered pretty bad on the storm. We really put a box culvert, a much larger culvert. We would calculate the flow and make sure that the flooding would never occur again by making a larger. The second access would be using the community center. It already has a gated access out of there for 911. We're really looking at just that as an emergency only. So that access would provide us with a second. And there's a potential third by way of the elementary school, which is available. We haven't explored it a lot other than it's available to work with. It could be a third. All we need is two. So we have plenty of options. Two are already established, so it's kind of a no-brainer.
Anybody else interested in comments or questions? Come on up. Please let folks know who you are.
I'm Mary Lynn Sansouci. I live on New Road. It seemed, without that piece of property, can we go any further? It just seems if that's taking up this area where we're going to put the building and we can't get the property, aren't we discussing something that can't go on, or did I miss something there? You said we can't purchase that piece of property that's essentially where the building is. Did I hear that properly?
Yeah, the landowner. At this point, the landowner does not want to sell. You're correct.
So aren't we kind of putting the horse before the cart here, or?
What we're looking for tonight is basic input on the concept from folks on whether or not this is a concept that looks good or looks like it's acceptable or viable. We have options to acquire property, whether people are willing to sell it or not. And depending on the strength of the reaction that we get in the room tonight and what we hear from people generally at other times, we will, you know, consider utilizing those options if they become necessary.
Yeah, my name is Donald Small. My only question is, what is the forecasted growth, if we need it, with that parcel that you're showing right there right now? Yeah, school growth.
It's going to basically stay flat, up 20, down 20.
I'm not sure if Donna's asking what
student enrollment.
Oh, okay.
It's pretty much flat.
We're projecting that it's going to stay pretty much flat for the foreseeable future in the area between 1,100 and 1,200 students is pretty much at this point where we project it being.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see significant growth in the next 20 years, and that is not and has never been a primary driving factor towards what we're doing.
Okay.
Although there is, as I understand it, still expansion capability. We could add an additional 175 students in the future if necessary to the facility, is what Mr. Bisson is telling me.
If I might interject here, Mr. Small, the issue of growth, it is very small. We've had minor increases in our student population at the junior senior high school. But the real issue is that the student growth that has occurred over the years, and there has been no expansion of the school facility. Let me give you some examples. There has not been an increase in the footprint of that building since 1965, and there were 261 students in that building in 1965. In 1987, the Cross Gymnasium was added, which allowed them to use the old gymnasium, and they converted that into two large classrooms, one the library, the second the music room. At that time, there were 356 students in 1987, so there was an increase. There was a couple of classrooms added, but almost 100 students more than in 1965. In 1998, they were renovations to that building. The renovations were cosmetic, as well as infrastructure, air exchange, windows, that kind of renovation. And the population was 550, but no additional classrooms were added. Today, in that building, there's nearly 625 students. And again, I have to emphasize that the footprint of that building has not changed since 1965, so we're really addressing an issue that's one that's finally caught up with us. There are at least seven or eight classroom teachers with no classrooms. They work in a variety of areas, visit, and you'll see that, and I know you're up there, so you've seen it. But that's really the issue for, and has been the issue for the facility committee. How do we deal with the enrollment that's there that we haven't dealt with over the years?
This, looking at what you got here right now, looks like it's a good idea, a good suggestion. Is there any abutting land that would be available sometime down the road if we needed to move off that footprint?
Yes.
Okay. That's all I want to know.
In fact,
because I worked on a school building study committee back in the, oh God, when was it, Dick? Long time ago.
Yes, sir.
And it's been given to us. And the growth projection back then was right. Substantial. I couldn't believe it, but it happened. It did peak, but now it's kind of leveling off. But I just want to make sure that we're not binding ourselves in somewhere we can't move.
In fact,
as far as acquiring land, I know if push comes to shove, we can do the eminent domain thing. I know I'm very familiar with that because my daughter lost her house over Newfields, and it wasn't for a community benefit. It was for the railroad, which is, as I don't know if you've seen recently, but the law now has changed on eminent domain here in the state of New Hampshire. So anyway, that's all I need to say. And like I said, what you've presented so far looks good. I know damn right and well it would go a lot further than that ball the golf course did.
Thank you, Don.
I think the town ought to buy the golf course.
I'll pass that along, Don.
Well, we need something around here for the seniors to do.
That's what we have these meetings for.
We got a lot of seniors that go down and play golf. If you take that away from them,
then we'll get even more seniors at these meetings.
Also, as part of this area here, there's 19 acres that's being given to the school department, free and clear, that's going to connect the elementary school to the high school, which will eventually, you know, connect to the middle school. So it'll be one big campus setting. And, speaking, I think I can speak for the facilities committee. I don't think there's anybody on the committee that wants to take land by eminent domain. I don't.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's nobody here that does. I don't think anybody up here wants to do that. I mean, I'm a New Englander. I've lived in Newmarket my whole life. But
so far.
you know, there's it's an issue that has to be addressed. And you know, we looked at numerous sites, and I mean, we worked hard on this, and we just, you know, I've had people come up to me tonight at my son's basketball game and say, "Why are you doing this?" You know, very upset about it. And I says, "Well, what should we do?" And they just,
that's their answer. I don't know.
And nobody seems to have an answer. Yet when we bring something forward, everybody, you know, and I mean, I would like the Weirds to come to us and say, you know, we will sell it, and this is what we want for it, and then we have something to negotiate and go from there. And you know, there's a lot of figures that are being bantered around. In my experience, a lot of, you know, rumors rarely are true, and they spread like wildfire. But there has been a lot of effort that's gone into this here. I wouldn't be here if I didn't believe that we needed to do something, because we've spent a tremendous amount of time on this. So, you know, if anybody else has any more questions.
Gary, if I can add two things. First of all, Don mentioned his daughter's house. I want to make it very, very clear that the Wyatt parcel does not include the parcel to the north of Moonlight Brook that includes their house. Their house is not at all what we're looking at. And secondly, even if land is given to us, we have to get taxpayer, we have to get voter approval to accept it. So ultimately, the decision is going to be up to the community. Even though we have money on hand, and even though 19 acres is being given to us, it's all up to the community to vote on and decide. So, sorry, thank you.
Hi. My name is Sarah Smith, and I'd like to applaud all you guys for working very hard on this. I think it's a real creative idea and exciting in a lot of ways. Just a thought. If perhaps the Weirs, is it? Is that the name?
Weird.
If perhaps their concern is the proximity of the school building to their home, the school could go where the ball fields are. There could be a flip-flop. So that's sort of a question, I guess.
Our understanding has been, and if there's anyone from the town here, that the, and I think it's true, the Landrock Field was built with federal grant money years ago. That comes with some strings attached, that no structure can be built on it. It has to remain for recreation use, period. Or they come back and they want their money plus interest, I would guess. But that's been our understanding as to why we're constrained in our ability to do anything with that particular parcel. Yeah, I mean, you might be able to say to them, we're going to take that and we're going to replace it with a comparable facility. That may be very true, and that's something we can take a look at. Rich.
Hi, Rich Alpern, 204 South Main again. Two questions. The footprint for the possible high school on the land that we can't buy yet, are we still entertaining the idea of an auditorium in that building?
It is in the footprint that you see there, but it can be easily unplugged.
Okay. My other question, the Carpenter property, Dan was talking a few minutes ago about two methods of egress off of South Main Street. One of them happens to be right along the side of my house, and not that I'm opposed about it, but if I could just get some thoughts as to about what I could expect to occur right there along the side of my house.
I don't know if anybody has the answer. You can handle that, Chris?
Actually, no.
Dan, is that where the access is?
Could Dan at least point to where we're talking about for the other folks who...
It isn't the access. That
was the emergency access.
Are you mentioning on this part of the property?
No.
This one?
Show them.
So over here?
This? Yeah.
Right there. Nothing's set in the sense of that's exactly going to be used as a primary or secondary. If there's some sensitivity, we're definitely going to be talking to people. I mean, that's part of the process after March, is to fine-tune the designs and find out if there are issues of buffers required, noise mitigation, any of those things would be definitely talked to. This is not set in stone. So if there are people, and I'm sure a lot of other people are going to be concerned with lighting and noise and traffic, and we always consider those things. So if this is a real issue, we'll look at buffers, we'll look at different ways. It might become a secondary only, where this might be the primary, which kind of makes sense. It'd be a crossroads. That kind of makes sense to be the primary anyhow. But nothing's been set, and abutters would be contacted.
And secondary means emergency.
Yeah.
Correct.
Use your microphone. Just remind folks up here to use your microphones, please.
Chet Jablonski, Bay Road. My question is money. With the proposal, which is nice, we're looking at this little high school, are we going to be able to offer our students the curriculum that they're going to need to compete in the 21st century? In other words, is this going to be a little private school? We're now up to what, $11,000 a student? Is there research being done on this by this board, or are we just going to put this for the voters and say, here it is, take it or leave it? I think we should know whether we're going to be able to afford it or not.
Kathy, do you want to
say anything to that, Kathy?
Well, in response to that, Chet, we currently meet all of the state standards relative to high school education in terms of mathematics and science, English, social studies, and the unified arts classes that our students have. Our students are afforded opportunities to attend the Seacoast School of Technology, which has been a wonderful relationship, so that youngsters have a chance to participate in career and vocational. In addition, because we are a small school and we are working very hard to keep costs at a reasonable level, we are doing things like virtual high school, which allows our students online classes using computers. We have approximately 30, it varies from semester to semester, but we have approximately 30 seats every semester that students access. The Seacoast School of Technology not only offers vocational programs, but very high-end academic programs in biotechnology and computer programming. We also have an opportunity to send students to Dover High School for cosmetology. So, in fact, we are a small high school, and in order to keep costs reasonable, we have to be able to access programs in a regional setting. But I feel that our students in Newmarket are competitive. Our high school students have made their annual yearly progress as designated by the Department of Education. They were one of the few area high schools for the past 3 years that have made their performance targets, and I think that we can be proud of their efforts. Curriculum is ever-changing. It's constantly changing, and it's inherent upon our staff, our professional staff, to continue to stay abreast of those changes. And I think that having the facility that gives us space to be able to have those computer classrooms that we desperately need, and to be able to have a language lab, which we don't have, I think that given the space will help us to continue to meet those needs in terms of curriculum.
Speaking for the school board, we insist that the administration create and innovate and exploit all the resources we have at our disposal to do the best job we can educating our kids. We sit up here because we believe that's an important thing, and we believe it can be done and is being done. And and we demand that of our staff, and they deliver it, we believe, on a daily basis.
So what you're telling me is that, in the crowd here, that we can afford it. In other words, your operating budget is going to stay basically the same because your student body is going to be the same. We're going to end up spending $25 million for a school, and we're going to be able to offer that curriculum that's necessary for these youngsters to compete in the 21st century, as is Dover, Portsmouth, Rochester, and the rest of the schools. I think this is the answer we have to know. There's no excuses in telling us about averages and so forth. I don't think averages cut it. We should be not even above average. These students should be flourishing in this school, not averages.
We believe they do. We believe they can. We believe they will. And we believe that's our commitment to them.
Let me.
The answer is yes.
I'd like to comment on the curriculum issue. I'm a college chemistry professor. I see first-year students all the time coming from all over the state and other places in the nation. And some of those kids happen to be Newmarket kids, and I can't talk about anybody in particular, but I know quite well that the students are pretty well served by the educational experience they've had in town. When we worry about the size of the institution and the opportunities that are available, I think what matters more is the folks that you have in the classroom working with the kids is probably more critical than the size of the institution. And I think we've been very fortunate that we've had some very strong and dedicated teachers over the years, despite some of the issues that we've had, facilities and other issues, that create the necessary support for students to be successful. Now, whether they are successful or not ends up being totally unpredictable by the time they become adults on their own and get into a different environment, whether they succeed or not. And we see kids who ought to be succeeding well struggle. We see kids that were struggling in high school flourishing when they get to college, and it's you can only predict it with about 25 or 30% predictability off of things like SAT scores. That's known from the research. So I can only talk for myself personally. Both of my kids went to Newmarket. They're doing very well in college. And we actually made a choice not to go the private route because we thought there was an advantage in being the small school setting, and it's worked out to our advantage.
Could I interject? You're probably going to speak to just what I was going to suggest. The committee, Mr. Jablonski did raise a good question here on the question of costs of operating three schools in the district versus what we're operating now. The committee did consider that, and there are some numbers on that, and I know the administration has spent some time thinking about how that would all work out, so I wanted to invite the superintendent to comment on that, or Chris.
Well, we did look at that because originally the committee felt that it was more cost-effective to have a school that was grades 6 through 12 because you can share staff, you share resources, nurse, secretaries, the whole gamut. But with the difficulties of land and finding a suitable piece in order to meet the needs, the recommendation was is that we split the two buildings, 6 through 8, and have a building 9 through 12. Mrs. Caswell and I sat down and reviewed the costs, and we absolutely acknowledge that running a third site will increase the budget. There's no question about it. We can't expect to have the single custodian that we have during the day try to be in two places at once. That's impossible. However, we have already begun to look at things like cafeteria. We won't need two cafeteria staffs. We'll only need one, and we'll satellite the other school. So we'll make all the food and prepare it, and the only thing you'd need in the other building would be the staff to serve it. And so there are a lot of possibilities of sharing our staff. Right now we have members of the middle school staff and the high school staff who teach across those grade levels, and we feel that we can still do that. It will be a scheduling challenge, there's no question about it, but we feel that we can do that. We believe that with the addition of a facility, it will be somewhere around $700,000 increase in the budget given a third building. And I'm talking about heat and lights, custodial, cleaning, all of the supplies that will be required on a daily basis to maintain a third site. I don't know, does that answer your question, Paul?
No, you were probably about to say it, so sorry. Thanks.
No, that's not my question. You went off in the left field with this. I'm asking you about the curriculum. We're talking here 5, 10 years, 15 years down the road, 20 years. You're not going to offer these students English, French, and Spanish. I imagine you're going to have to start picking up some German. I imagine you're going to start picking up some Russian. Are you going to be able to do this in this school? Are we going to be able to afford this stuff? And what type of mathematics are we going to be able to teach in science? We're going to stay where we are. we're going to have to expand these programs. Are we going to be able to afford to expand these programs? When I mentioned the other schools, this is what I was talking about. These other schools already have these programs. Are we going to be able to do it? And if we can do it, are we going to be able to afford it?
Mr. Ransdell, go ahead.
If I may, I'd like to address Mr. Zamonski's question because I think I understand what he's trying to ask. With the current facility that we have and the need to continually modernize programs and move forward with our curriculum, we are very, very limited in our ability to do that. A new facility can do nothing but enhance our ability to modernize and develop those new programs. And I again go back to science as the best example. Having been to Mr. Thayer's room several times, the room is really not designed as a modern science classroom. It's designed as a classroom that we teach science in. And modern science classrooms have changed. When we were in school, we sat down with a book, we learned our chemistry, we memorized a lot of facts, and we took our tests, and we did labs once in a while. Whereas in a modern classroom, we put our hands on things more often. We learn by doing. And our current facility is not capable of allowing us to do that. And it's not allowing our students to do that. And Mr. Jablonski's point's very well taken by me that this new facility will allow us to grow programs and will allow us to meet those evolving needs over time. The cost factor and the can we afford it question is a question for when you do have to expand those programs. You have to deal with that when the time comes. However, in terms of a facility, we would have to expand our facility at some point to meet those very needs Mr. Jablonski's talking about. And we would have to cross that bridge now, or sooner rather than later. We're not dealing with the major facilities and infrastructure issue. Then we are really dealing with the programmatic design and a program development issue, because we do have a facility, at least we should have a facility when we see the final plans, that will allow us to make those expansions in a way that makes sense and a way that keeps up with the changing world.
Hi, my name's Tammy Lang and I live on One Langs Lane. I've lived here my whole life. When I graduated high school, there was like 42 kids in my class. My son is in 11th grade, and I think this year they have, well, at one point they had 105 in their class. My son, for an alternative language this year, was not interested in Spanish or anything like that, or French. They allowed him to take a Lakota Sioux Indian language online, and we had to pay half the course, but he has to maintain a certain average in order to pass, or we have to pay the other half. So I think that's a good way to offer kids a different way of learning, and he is loving it. So
thank you. Are there other folks who, okay, we have a lot of repeat visitors. I'm gonna be looking for the rest of you in a few minutes.
I, last year when the golf course was presented to us, there were some intensive traffic studies that were presented to us. I'm wondering if any traffic studies have been done, or at least thought about how traffic is going to work, school buses getting in, school buses getting out of the area. Has that been looked at yet?
The unique thing about this particular project is nothing changed. The same kids go through the same front door in the sense of the road, so there is really virtually no change in traffic. We'll be using the same access point, and that's the beauty about this site. Traffic-wise, we will still do a traffic study. That's a part of what we do at the next phase, but we don't anticipate anything of significance simply because we're not changing any population or any movement.
To the extent that we have children crossing the road, though, to use, if there's a facility built there, we may have to have some kind of provision put in.
Right. But crosswalk, maybe some blinking lights, like, but yeah, nothing of a same kind of dramatic significance we had where the golf course had a smaller traffic count. This is, traffic count will be the same. So we're not anticipating any dramatic changes other than doing a traffic study to validate that.
And to the extent that we have fewer buses in a given area, it should actually improve the flow
of at least on the sites for dropping off and picking up.
Because at least you'd be able to spread out the parking throughout the facility. Right now you're heavily concentrated around one building. And by having two buildings, you have the opportunity to break up the traffic. You could accept children and release them at separate times. Right now you're kind of one building, you're kind of like inundating the major route. So there's other options to actually soften the load on that main artery. So no, we see this as a big plus.
I can't let this go. Going back to my idea about moving the high school building to the playing fields, it may afford the opportunity to have a shared heating system as well between the two facilities. And maybe as an example of a school system that has that is Merrimack Valley School. Mm-hmm. And it's also a wood heating system, which is very exciting. Mm-hmm. So I'd encourage the group to look at that.
We have looked at wood heating. We did for last year's facility, and we're also looking at the power generation idea that's been kicking around town for a while. So thank you for that.
Todd Roger, Lumberland Drive. This plan seems to have a lot of advantages where the golf course plan had disadvantages. So it looks very appealing. And I'm guessing at this point that you, because you're in negotiations on these properties, that you can't talk much about money. But it seems to me that this is a key element here. And I'm very curious, and I think the voters are going to be very curious about what's the cost of this program versus the cost of the golf course program. Which was turned down pretty hard. I'm hoping this is going to look good when we look at the dollars, and I'm wondering, what's the plan for revealing some of these costs and putting together a plan to really sell this program to the town at large.
They've been appraised.
Yeah. I think my memory is that the golf course was like $3 million. 3.7. This is less than half of that number. All the land that we're talking about here. I like to think so. And what else did you? Oh, the total cost.
How about the building?
Yeah, the building cost is significantly less. We were looking at 32 last time, Dan. Now we're looking, I think the number is, 20 million, 20.6. So it's about a third less. We're looking at around 20 million. There is an X factor, which is we haven't really discussed the extent to which we want to make changes to the current building for the middle school. So that's kind of still a variable that's out there, but I don't anticipate you'll be seeing anything in near the cost you saw last time, I think it's fair to say.
And the extra operating costs?
I think the superintendent just mentioned we're looking at a range of $700,000 a year in additional operating cost simply by virtue of having three buildings instead of two. But that's also something that we're constantly looking at to see how can we achieve economies to offset that. But I can't tell you, it's going to be more operating cost. There's no question.
Other comments? Dan wanted to say something.
One unique thing about this property, because you're having basically three schools on one site, there are some hidden savings, such as maintenance. If we do put an internal road, which we're striving for, you can see here, your maintenance is under basically one area. So even with the golf course, that would have been a back and forth. So there is going to be some hidden values when it's all said and done. It's hard to see them, but think about lawn care. If you have a machine that you could buy that does more acreage, here it can service three buildings. Even with the golf course, a real good machine could probably only service one site. So this will have some economy just because it's kind of a campus style. And over the years, we've been at this some 22 years, we're seeing more and more schools considering campus type atmospheres for the simple reason of managing buildings as a maintenance. So this has a huge advantage in that respect compared to last year. So there are some hidden savings. And back to energy, with the discussions of energy and having what's that term?
The microturbines.
We've already talked about the fact that since they're all close together, that could tie in all three schools. If it's ready for us, we tie in the high school immediately and make provisions to tie in the middle and the elementary school. So we would definitely embrace that whole theory. And because it's a campus style, it could be done much more cost effectively than having two totally separate sites. So this has some hidden positives that it's hard to articulate in dollar values, but they're there.
There's no reason not to tie in the community center also, if that's the concept you're working on. It's right there.
You said the cost of the building was $20.6 million?
That's the estimate I have I'm looking at right now. That's also been shared with the facilities committee.
Okay, is that hard money, and what about the soft money?
I think that, is that all in, Dan? Please, why don't you break it down for us?
I have one other question now I can think about also.
Sure.
Is a plan C in place also? Are you still trying to negotiate with other schools in terms of outsourcing our students?
Yes.
And
just while Dan comes up, just as he's getting ready to speak, it might be helpful to address the timeline that may be anticipated in terms of why A&E now and why, you know, that's why we're doing that piece. We're looking to do that piece now, perhaps, and hold off so that when we do a building bond, we have a firm fixed cost. We're not doing here's what we believe it should be based on the current economy kinds of models. So if that timeline could be addressed, I think that could be helpful to people.
Cost is always a thing people banter about. You read things from different school districts, and it depends how you ask the question, because you can ask how much the project costs, and has somebody mentioned, does that include soft costs? Let me just explain, there are like three levels of costs. Typically, it's the building costs, which you can compare with other facilities, because a building is a building. Site costs can vary from school to school, and so there's the site costs, and then the soft costs. Soft costs is A&E fees, is furniture, is all the intangibles, the clerk of the works, the attorney who works for the school district. There are about 60 items under soft costs. We've shared that with the superintendent and the school board. On this project, I'll just break it down. And again, these are numbers budgetary on today's numbers. They're not hard numbers. But on the high school part, the building alone is about $14.3 million. We've also allocated $300,000 on the middle school to do some work there. The site cost on the high school is 5.5. There's a lot of field work. On the middle school, we got $500,000 to do some correction around the middle school. So that's $20.6 million that was just bantered about. That's building and site, including $800,000 for the middle school. Then the soft cost, as I mentioned to you, is about 60-some-odd items. That's a net of 4.1. Right now, we have a budget number for discussion purposes only of 24.7. It doesn't mean that's the number. Once we go out to bid, depending on the bidding market, and we've seen it softening lately, could be less. If something happens with the economy, it could go the other way. That's why there's a discussion about how we're going about this. To do estimates in a volatile climate is very, very difficult to try to control. You can go to the pump to get gas up. 4 months ago, you were paying $3. You go right now, it's 2.25. If you went a month and a half ago, it was 2.10, 2.12. So, it's kind of a crystal ball. This chart really just tries to show the ways of approaching trying to get a project move-in date. And what's really strange about it is when you look at A and B, they both start at the same timeline, where you do A and E fees with land purchase, or A and E fees, this is with land purchase, you're putting out the bid at the same time. This one says that you do A&E fees, and all you're going to do is go out to bid, but not bond the amount for the building cost. So this is like just the upfront cost for A&E. These two timelines work together because by the time you're done putting documents together, you get all your permits in hand, there's about an 8-month lag by the time you get the documents ready to bid. Then once you do that, you, on a typical project, you get the bids in and you award it, and then you start the construction. At that point, you made your decision in 2007, and it just keeps going. So after the bids are in and the ground thaws out and you can work on the site, you've got about another 18 months of construction. It gets completed, you got a month to move in, get it all prettied up, and move-in date is basically July, August of 2009. The way that's being proposed is that when you get the bids in, there'll be a warrant article again in 2008 in March. You'll actually have a hard number. It won't be an estimate, which is this would be. So you actually have a hard number. If that number seems to be a issue, we can put alternates in the bids, so you can either lower it or raise it, or you can negotiate with the low bidder. So you have an opportunity to revisit that number, and you can bring it before the people to vote on it. So it isn't a done deal when you vote in March just for NA fees. Same thing, the trigger starts again for construction about 18 months. July, August is still the same moving date. So the method of what has been done in the past of having a March bond vote and it's a go till it's completed is the same time as having a two-warrant system. And that's what's being proposed, is just spend the money for the A&E and then come up with a hard number so the public can look at it, digest it. It'll be a hard building. It'll actually be fully designed and be comprehended very, very well. So you have two shots at it, and that's why we're looking at that system.
And maybe you should mention on the A&E that is good for 2 years. It's not like if it gets voted down, it's gone.
Right. The thing about the A&E fees, if all the homework is done and all the design is done according to your needs, that design does not have to be changed ever again. It just has to be brought back for what following year. You may want to tweak it a little bit, but there isn't a heck of a lot you can really do if you do your homework. If you have the needs are going to basically reflect the design. And the unique thing we're doing here, too, is making sure the auditorium issue, which has been up in the air, is a plug-in, plug-out. We fully intend that this facility could be built with or without the auditorium. And we can actually put it out to bid as an alternate, so we can get an actual cost of it with and without. So we're doing that because the Facilities Committee is still trying to gather consensus, and it's a hard one to get. Do you want it or you don't? And it's basically a couple $1 million question. You know, do you want it for a couple million or you don't? And that's going to be in there as a plug-in, plug-out. So there'll be an opportunity of looking at that as an option.
Right, and the approach Dan has talked about, which is option B up here, which is what the Facilities Committee recommended we consider, you could very easily have a warrant article for the building and a separate warrant article for the auditorium.
Correct.
So you can say, if I don't want the auditorium, I can vote yes for the building and no on the auditorium, and we don't have to worry about that item sinking the entire project.
And it'll be hard numbers. No, I can't because of the economy. There's no.
It could be.
You don't know what the competitive bidding process is going to do for you.
You know what the market is.
In a year.
We've seen numbers come down in the past month. We've seen about a 10% decrease in the past couple of months. It went up at a spike around 25% about 4 months ago, 5 months ago. It's volatility. We've had different issues around the world. That affects oil, and oil affects everything from plastics to coppers to moving materials, and it's something that happens. When you get the bid and you want to delay the project 1 year, it will never be any lower than that time.
And the state's going to offer us how much?
30%.
30% state aid over the life of the bond. So you get reimbursed 30%.
Not just for land and building.
For the whole thing, including all the work you've done in the past 2 years. We did all the analysis. That's all reimbursable because that's all focused towards this, the end means of trying to provide a building. So all the monies you spent in the past 2 years on our firm and other people doing different studies is all reimbursed.
And believe me, we track that very carefully.
Yeah.
Given the fact that we're trying to build this building on land that at this point doesn't look like we can buy, has anybody thought maybe we could simply build a new school around the existing school, attach it to it, connect it to it, use the current parking lot on the back and on the side, and then maybe put parking across the street, similar to what Co-Brown has, where they got parking across the street and a tunnel underneath Route 4? Has that been thought about at all? And my other question is, they're talking about the cogeneration with the microturbines. Doesn't that all hinge on natural gas pipelines coming into town? And do you know something we don't know about them coming into town? Those are my two questions.
Rich, I think it's highly unlikely I know anything you don't know. I don't know. I can't answer the question of whether the cogen project hinges on and is dependent on natural gas coming into town. I know that's a topic of discussion, but we're not counting on it, and we don't require it to happen in order to have this project happen. It's simply something else we're looking at. Dan, do you want to address the first question of? I think the answer is yes, but you can address it in more detail.
We actually did a couple of plans that the school board has trying to wrap around the building. That was one of the options. There was an option list at one time that Chris kept on emailing me with idea 45, and I kept on addressing as best I could, and we came down to maybe five or six, and one of them was wrapping the building, and we tried. We ran out of room. We basically ran out of room. What's the big killer on the existing building is you keep bearing space in windowless situations, and that's not good for teaching staff and students. So we really worked out a plan, and we just filled it up, and we just ran out of space. We just can't do it. And we looked at trying to get as much of the teaching space as possible with windows. So we're winding up with courtyards. We're winding up with really difficult situations. You really don't want to trap people in courtyards or having maintenance of trying to remove snow in different areas. So we just simply ran out of room. Again, the river is a big issue too. There's not much you can do in that direction. You're kind of bound by two property lines, a road and the stream. So that kind of were the restrictions. And no, we did ask, can we move the stream? And Jim Gove says no.
Well, I have the same question, but I was wondering why you can't go up to a third floor.
That's a very good question. It's asked all the time. The biggest problem is seismic earthquake requirements, and these buildings were not ever built for seismic to today's standards. So to do that, you would destroy so much of the building below that to do that. In fact, we looked at that quite in some depth in Portsmouth, and Randall could speak to that. We wound up doing analysis after analysis, and we had to destroy a good significant part of a building because it just didn't meet seismic. We had a structural engineer already review it, and he's kind of written it off as a very expensive alternative. Plus, when you do that, what do you do with the students who were down below during the construction? There's a lot of other issues.
Anyone else out there who hasn't had a chance to say anything? Including the last two people to come in? I'm not going anywhere briefly in case something occurs to someone in the next couple of minutes. Anybody on the board want to interject anything that to respond to anything?
Chris, I just wanted to remind everyone that this is the first public hearing that we've had on this concept, but in fact in January there will be two hearings, and one specifically for any bonding that will take place on the March warrant. So keep your eye on the newspaper for that public hearing for bonding purposes. That would be a bond that would be specific to the money needed for the land and the architect and engineering fees. There will also be a second hearing January 16th on the budget, and we'll be reviewing this year's budget. The issue around land is interesting because the Facilities Committee recommended that we try to buy the land without bonding, which means that we use monies that the school district currently has. And the question comes up, well, how do you do that? Right now, we have an agreement with the Open Space Committee, the Town Open Space Committee, for approximately $500,000 of money that you've already appropriated that will be earmarked for land for the school. We have the ability to access impact fees, which you know that developers have been setting aside for a number of years. That money is used for infrastructure specific to the town and school, so we are in the process right now of putting together our request to the town for impact fees. We are currently eligible for almost $200,000. And in addition to that, we have had and received clearance from the Department of Revenue that the $1 million that is currently in the school district's capital reserve fund for building expansion is $1 million that we can also use a portion of that money for the purchase of land. So if we are successful in our negotiations, it appears that the community will be able to purchase land and not have a tax impact on the citizens.
I want to add two things. First of all is, I don't know if it's been said before, and I apologize for having come in late. The middle school, we're contemplating grades 5 through 8. We need to get rid of the trailers at the elementary school. They're well past any useful life they may once have had. And if you doubt me, feel free to drive by. So that's what we're contemplating for the middle school, having made some renovations to the building. And the other thing, I've already forgotten. Anybody who wants to go take a look through either of the buildings at any time, feel free to do so. Call up the office, the administrative offices, and let them know that you'd like to come in and take a look around. They always welcome visitors. They're very accommodating. And we're happy to help you arrange that if you'd like to.
Okay, I don't see any other folks demanding to get up here. I'm going to turn it back over to the school.
Oh, here we go.
I just tried to hand it off.
Todd Roger. As I understand it, we want to buy the land and do the A&E this year with money that we have, and we need a vote to do that this year. Is that correct?
Partly right. We do need a bond for the A&E cost, right, which would be around 1.2 something.
Okay, we don't need a vote to acquire the land?
Yes. We need approval to utilize the money that we have on hand to acquire land with, okay, and also to accept donated land.
Okay, and I get my question is, When you ask the voters to do that, how much of a plan will you have for the total package? In other words, I as a voter am not going to be excited about, I'm not going to feel good about voting. I mean, even though it looks cheap this year, you know, you're not asking me to no tax impact or anything like that, but when I vote to go ahead this year with the land and the A&E, I'm implying that I'm willing to go ahead with the whole $25 million package the following year. Mm-hmm. And how clear are we going to be about what that $25 million package or whatever it is going to look like?
When you get the A&E, you're going to have an actual bid. It'll be all the permits will be paid for, which you'll have to have no matter what. You know, if you choose to purchase the land and you vote for the A&E, the architectural engineering, that is all your permits, all your studies. It includes going out to bid on the building, so you'll have an actual cost rather than in last March they had a figure of I don't even remember what it was, 34,000, and that's just based on tables that the state pretty much gives you. It's by county, you know, Rockingham County, you know, it's gonna, they calculate $143 a square foot, or, you know, they have certain figures that they use, and whether you're doing it in Newmarket or Exeter or anywhere in Rockingham County, it'll be the same. The A&E, you'll actually have a design of a school in on your warrant article. If they do it, they may not do it that year. They may wait a year, with all the permits and everything, that $1,278,800 will purchase your traffic studies, your surveying, your geotech, your archaeologist, your chimney modeling. It is from everything from A to Z for a new school. And that will be good for 4 or 5 years or whenever the town does decide that, okay, we need to do something. You know, the building, the roof's caving in. We have to do something. You will be right to the point where you can break ground. You will have a bid in hand from a construction company, which if it's 4 or 5 years out, obviously that's going to change. But they can, you know, tweak that, and you'll have a figure on the warrant article. It won't be an off-the-wall figure that where Dan comes up here and says, well, you know, we don't know. It's somewhere around here. And that's tough when you're talking, you know, $3 million for me. It's a lot of money. So that's what the A&E is for. You're not really committing to building a new school the following year. It might not be for 2 or 3 years. It depends on how things go.
In terms of what you're going to know this year when you go into the voting booth, you're going to know we have very detailed specifications on what the new building has to include in order to accommodate the program that we have and that we reasonably foresee needing, also in light of what the state requires us to have. We're going to have these, and this is one of them, these two-dimensional drawings that show you roughly how the building is going to lay out, and you're welcome to grab onto that. We will probably talk to Mr. Bisson about having some kind of more or less an artist rendering of what the exterior of the building would look like in light of direction we've already received from the task forces that we've had in terms of what the exterior and the roof system will look like. What you won't know is what color the paint is going to be, what the fixtures are going to look like. You won't have that level of detail, but you have an idea of how the building is going to lay out and what it's going to contain. Exactly all the details of how it's going to work out, you're not going to know when you go into the voting booth, because that's what, as Gary has just said, that's what the next step is for. But you will have some idea of what it is you're being asked to buy in the long run.
Yeah, but I would like to know this year whether it's going to be $20 million or 25 or 30.
Our best estimate right now is $24.7 million.
Okay.
Based on what we know today. Understanding that, and believe me, if I could eliminate all uncertainty, I would. But there is going to be a level of uncertainty in the bidding process that we just don't control. Thank you.
Chris, may I make a comment?
You can, of course.
To address that issue, I think that, you know, you're absolutely right, and some people would see that it's an implied support of the building project itself. However, you know, how I would take that, you know, should I be so lucky and choose to, you know, run again or to be a member of this board, I would see that as the community's consent that we need to be actively looking at our school facilities. And if that A&E bond is approved, what I would take that to mean is that it's now our job to do the due diligence to bring back the most cost-effective and the best plan that we can to voters a year from now or 2 years from now or whenever that would next take place. Not that we are assuming that, okay, we've got A, B's in the bag. That, I wouldn't take it that way at all. What I would say is we have to come back to you with a plan that makes sense to the community, that meets the community's needs, and is seen as cost-effective as possible to deliver the kinds of services that our kids need and that we want for our kids. And if we don't do that, then that bond a year or 2 years down for the actual construction, that's why the community needs to make that decision on the actual hard cost, the bid cost, rather than an estimate at this point. I think that's the reason the committee felt that it's really more intellectually honest to take it in those steps so that we are delivering a real cost now and a real cost in stage two, and not a real cost now plus conceptual costs in stage two. So I'd like to think it would imply support, but I think that, in reality, we need to bring a well-developed plan to you for the actual development and construction of a building, not just the assumption that, okay, we've got the A&E, now let's just get a plan to them. So.
And we have had 100 people in the community sign up for various task forces, and they would be activated the day after, if with good luck in a following wind, we have a successful vote this March. We would be looking for extensive input from the community on all those details that we've talked about. And that it's our responsibility to make sure that gets done, and we hope that we do our best to meet it.
I have one quick question. The question is in regards to the monies that's going to be spent for this school. Is this board or this administration doing any research in regards to the population projections in this community? Not only this community, but the state of New Hampshire and also eastern part of the United States. Are we talking about the student body staying the same for 5-10 years? If it drops, are we better off to look at an equation and say, hey, you know what, $25 million with an increase of an operating cost and so forth, maybe outsourcing our students and looking at this and having a plan and so forth down the road and seeing what's happening before we bring in this Taj Mahal here. Is that being done, or is this something you people have been thinking about, or are you just not going to do it? I think this is what I was assertion to. Are you doing anything in terms of a projection, any type of research for us? I'm just not going to go in here and vote for a $25 million high school and then have in 5 years have it half full. That's what I'm saying. When I asked Chris the question, he said, yes, what? I mean, are you still negotiating with Brentwood or Barrington or Exeter or Portsmouth, or what are you doing with as far as outsourcing the students? I realize the community wants their identity, but, you know, we don't know. And I think there are projections out there that can give us a pretty good insight in terms of what we want to do and how the voters want to vote for the school.
I'll speak for the facilities committee on the issue of the projections. And I've been on the last two versions of the facilities committee, so I've seen the projections over the past 15 years. We did have a growth spurt that we're paying for now in terms of constraints in the building, and we're flattening out, as has been mentioned. In fact, we've had more growth, I believe, at the high school level than at the elementary because of people moving into town and sending their kids to the high school. There have been discussions with other school systems around us. Essentially, nobody is interested in talking with us. At the moment. The only place we've had distinct negotiations with is Barrington, and I believe that they're on track to build something by the year
2014.
So if we would like to wait, that might be an option for us. At the moment, we're not sure the building and many of its facilities will last that long while we wait. Looking at the option of trying to work with other towns, we're very limited in terms of, we're not in a strong position to negotiate with other folks about that. And it would require significant change in the way that the community interacts with the school. We'd be talking about the high school kids will no longer be in town. They'll be going somewhere else. What does that mean in terms of there being mules? Don't know. What happens to the sports, where is that going to happen, busing issue, et cetera. So there are lots of other issues associated with that we weren't getting the messages that was the way that we should be going. However, if all the other options are taken off the table, that may be what we're left with. So it's certainly been looked at. I'd like to turn the meeting back over.
In fact, we looked at population studies from NESDAQ at our last meeting a week or 10 days ago or
NESDAQ's
so.
NESDAQ's an organization that's regional and helps do school numbers projections.
We have a population study that was done, I don't know, 10 years ago or so, and Last year, the then town planner, Clay Mitchell, sat down and counted the number of households and the number of children that we have, and came up with an actual rate of children per household that was higher than the projections that we have received from what I'll call more kind of academic sources. This is just a simple head count. So we take all that into account, and we look at the tea leaves, and we keep careful track of the number of children in local daycares and the number of children in local nursery schools. And we keep track of the people moving in and moving out of the community by getting in touch with local real estate agents and getting a sense from them on the ebb and flow of things. And we put all that information together. And our best estimate is that the school population is going to remain relatively level for the foreseeable future. No significant growth and no significant subtraction. We believe, and it's only a belief, it's only a projection, that we're going to remain in the area of 1,100 to 1,200 students for the foreseeable future. When we've experienced growth, it's come very unusually. It's come primarily in our middle school and high school, and not from our kindergarten grades. We do experience bubbles of students. I think Mrs. Lang alluded to the current junior class is over 100 kids. That's an unusually large class. But we do have these bubbles that move through our system every now and then, and we kind of expand to deal with it, and then we move that group along. But our best estimate is we're going to be in the 1,100 to 1,200 range in the foreseeable future. That's the best answer I can give.
Okay. I'd like to turn it back over to the board.
Do we have an agenda, or what are we doing? No. Is there anything else folks would like to share this evening? If not, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.